So today we're going to talk about working as an F1 student with CPT and OPT and STEM OPT, and I'm going to break each of those down into three sections, which is the timeline for when to apply for that visa, the rules and restrictions of that visa, and then some tips and tricks from having done it. Do you hate vertical video? Is this the hill I should die on? I don't know. Let me know. Disclaimer, I'm obviously not an international student advisor nor a lawyer. This is not legal advice. So if you have questions and you want to get the most up-to-date answers, go ask your school. In terms of the generic F1 student visa, this is the first visa you'll probably get. And luckily it is the one where they will handhold you the most. And so after you get admitted, they will probably just email you and mail you, and you just don't need to worry so much about the timeline because you can just follow what they say. One thing to note though is very early on, you'll want to get a social security number because a social security number is required to like work and get paid in the US. And so for me, like I think in my first month or so of landing in the US, I went to the pain of like sitting in the office for hours and doing all that stuff, but it was so worth it because it's required for everything else. Okay, F1 tips and tricks. If you are Googling like, can I babysit off campus? Can I make money from a YouTube channel? Can I, like, along those lines? The answer is just no. If you are an F1 student and you're doing any of these like off-campus income generating activities, including online businesses in which you work and generate money, that is not allowed under your visa. I'm gonna just save you a lot of time. I know that you're looking for a loophole. I've looked for a loophole. I think it's better safe than sorry, because the consequences, again, of like breaking your visa is not being allowed in the US forever, actually. But I mean, there's like lighter consequences too, but the point is it's actually really serious. Okay, another tip slash trick, these are mostly tricks, is that it takes 2 consecutive semesters before you qualify for CPT and OPT, which are visas you have as an F1 student that allow you to work off campus, is primarily what people use them for. And so, you need 2 consecutive semesters. If you don't do that, it resets the 2 consecutive semesters requirement to begin like applying for a CPT or OPT visa. Okay, so now for rules of the F1 visa. You need to be enrolled as a full-time student and you can only work on campus. So this is like prior to getting a CPT, OPT, whatever, you can only work on campus jobs. And that's very specifically defined for your school. So the way to access those is to go into your school's job portal and they'll have a filter for like on campus versus off campus. And you need to do the on campus ones. What I mean by like they have a specific filter is, for example, let's say someone's looking for a babysitter near campus. That's not on campus. But if a school department is hiring like a librarian or like, you know, a TA or something, that's usually an on-campus job. In terms of hours, you can only work up to 20 hours per week. This can be across multiple jobs, but it's max 20 hours per week during term time. If it's not during term time, you can actually work up to 40 hours per week for an on-campus job. So if the next year you are coming back as a student at the same institution, then you can continue your job like during the summer. So for example, I worked at like a school newsletter and then I also manned the photo booth set during the summer, but only when I was still a student at that school the next semester. Okay, so let's say in normal cases, freshman year is over, you've done 2 consecutive semesters. That means you can now apply for CPT and technically OPT, but most people save OPT for after they graduate. So something to note is that the really great thing about CPT and OPT is that you can work like these off-campus jobs that you're probably really excited about. Okay, so we are on to the CPT visa and its timeline. Now, just look at your school portal, but when I Googled CPT timeline, the school that came up first said that you should apply up at minimum 2 weeks before the start date of your job because it takes their office like a week to process your application. This is very short and definitely earlier is better. But yeah, if you want to work off campus during the summer, for example, after freshman year or after sophomore year or whatever, you're going to need to apply for a CPT visa and apply early. Now, tips and tricks. And again, these are mostly tricks. I should just start calling them tricks. You can have a CPT visa for up to 12 months. Now note, if you hit 12 months or go over 12 months, then you become ineligible for OPT, which is again what most international students use to work after you graduate. So that is a bad situation. You'll actually, if you do the math out, like most people will spend 3 summers working after freshman, sophomore, junior year, and at most you'll do 3, 6, 9 like months of that. So it's actually pretty like hard to hit that 12 months mark unless you're working during the school year or if you transfer like I did and things like that. But yeah, just remember 12 months. If you actually transfer, make sure you don't hit the 12 months mark. Now on to the rules and regulations for your CPT visa. So when you apply, you actually have to tell the government how this is integral to your major as well as to your curriculum. And I'm sure your school will help you with this, but you essentially justify like, this is what I studied in class and this is how it relates to this internship. This is fairly broad. Like, I've never seen anyone personally get rejected over having a bad connection between those. So like I said, the CPT visa is actually quite flexible, but you are going to need to justify that. What happens then is you're going to hand all these paperwork to your school. Your school is going to issue you a new I-20, and actually in that I-20, you're going to be able to see that you have CPT authorization. Note that that CPT authorization is for a specific company and a specific duration, so make sure that's accurate. You actually can have multiple CPT authorizations for different companies at the same time. Just make sure your start and end date are correct and make sure the company you're working for is correct. It's actually tied to that company. So we're now on to OPT, which is what most of my friends who are international students use to work after they graduated. Technically, you can use this when you're still a student in school. It's just that it eats into the 12 months that you have, which most people do not want. There's very good reasons for wanting a full 12 months with your employer, including the fact that it gives you time to apply for other visas. Anyways, okay, so on to the timeline. Now remember, as I said, every visa you do is harder than the one before it in terms of applying and takes longer and is more like substantial. So we're now onto the OPT visa, and you can apply up to 90 days before you graduate. USCIS, I don't know if people call it that, but I call it that, can take 5 months to respond to you. It's really like, it really depends on a whole lot of factors. And they have to receive your application at least before 60 days after you graduate. So those are three requirements you have to meet. Once they've received it and it's pending, you'll probably be in a good spot, but you want to apply as early as you can, AKA 90 days before the end of your program. Also note that at least at my school, and I actually think at most schools, it would be a two-step process for application. So you do all of this paperwork, you send it to your school, and then they give you a new I-20 with their like authorization for OPT, and they'll give you like a list of other requirements that you have to fulfill. So then you have to go and do that whole thing, prepare it, remember to scan and keep records of all of this, and then send that to the government. I'm noting that it's a two-step process because you might procrastinate and then be like, oh, I'm just going to finish the first step in time, and then boom, the school is going to be like, actually, you have a whole other step to complete, and by the way, it's longer. Some tips and tricks for OPT. Okay, so after you graduate, you can only be unemployed for 90 days, at which point I think, I don't actually know what happens, I think your visa becomes invalidated or something. But what's also important to note is that you need to tell USCIS directly that you've started your job, where you've started, etc. Otherwise, they start counting your 90 days. The website is also pretty disastrous because there's no login. Like, you can't create an account yourself. The government has to email you. So make sure that you've gotten that email from the government to create an account to tell them that you started your job. Otherwise, ask your school about it, or you'll be like me, where USCIS will be like, you've been unemployed for 90 days, even though I was working. And you know, you now need to sign a bunch of forms. Otherwise, you will be like deported. Note that if you leave the country after you graduate but have not applied for your next visa, it invalidates your ability to apply for OPT or your next visa. This is just a general rule of thumb, actually. If you leave the country and your current student visa expires but you have not applied for your next visa, it's going to invalidate like the entire process. So definitely do not do that. Okay, also fun little tip. So like I said, you have 12 months of OPT usually, like after you graduate from your bachelor's, for example, but if you go for another degree, like your master's, you get an additional 12 months. Okay, so now rules and regulations of your OPT. Like I said, it is 12 months, and one of the very cool things about this visa is it's actually extremely flexible, which, as you know, is kind of rare. So for example, you can work multiple jobs, you can work contracting jobs where you're not a W-2 employee. You can work for yourself by starting a business. You can volunteer and have an unpaid job and still qualify for OPT. So, I mean, that's not a complete list, but all that is to say, getting the OPT should be simple in the sense that you should be able to find a job within those categories if you would like to stay in the US, and it's actually quite flexible. And you should take advantage of that if you want to. However, again, you have to justify to the government why this training is directly related to what you studied. You'll need to write up a whole thing about it. I'm sure someone will help you, hopefully at your school or like the company you work at. I don't think I've personally met anyone who's been rejected for having that mismatch, but the government becomes more and more serious about making sure that you're fitting into the right categorization based on what you studied and what you're currently working in. Just a minor thing to note, but one of the additional pieces of documentation you get as an OPT student is your EAD card. I talked about this in my last video, and I also talked about if you lose that, you have to reapply for your OPT. You don't just get to ask the government for a new card because you forgot yours, so make sure you protect that card with your life. Okay, we are on to the fourth and final visa, which is STEM OPT. In terms of the timeline for application, again, you can apply up to 90 days before the expiration date of your OPT visa, which you will be able to see on your EAD card. Yes, apply as early as possible, which is at that 90-day mark, because the government takes a long time, potentially, to respond to you. So like I've been saying this whole time, as you progress through visas, they are longer applications, so they're harder to apply for, and they become more restrictive. So, for example, with your STEM OPT, you have to have paid regular employment, as in you can't be like a contract worker, a gig worker, working for yourself, etc. Also, you have to make sure that the degree you have qualifies you for the STEM OPT visa. The government has a very specific list and you will just match yourself to that list. But yeah, you need to, if this is something that you want, so if you want the additional 24 months with the STEM OPT visa, then you want to make sure that the thing that you're studying actually qualifies for this visa based on this list. And finally, in order for the company to like let you apply for the STEM OPT visa, they have to be in the E-Verify database. I'm fairly sure they can just like add themselves to this database, but if you're working at a smaller company, so like if you're not working at Google, if you're working at a startup and they don't know this stuff, or you're the first international person they've hired, then I would definitely way in advance, like 6 months in advance, tell them that they need to be an E-Verified database company and get them to go through that process. Okay, on to rules and regulations for the STEM OPT visa. Like I said, I probably should have started with this, it gives you an additional 24 months if you studied one of the majors that qualifies under the list that the government has. So that means if you, let's say, study computer science, instead of being able to just work for 1 year in the US, you can work for 3 years. And what's also really great about that is future visas are often lotteried, like the H-1B is lotteried once or maybe twice a year. But the point is, the longer you can stay in the US, the more chances you have to get that lottery. Like the OPT visa, it is a two-step process, which I'm just reiterating because if you're a procrastinator, it's going to be sad when you find out you have that second step. So you have to fill out all of this stuff and then you give it to your school, and then your school will pen for however many days and give you back again a new I-20 that has your STEM OPT authorization. From there, this is the visa that actually requires a fairly substantial amount of work from your company, not only because they have to be in the E-Verify database, but also because you have to write a Form 1983 training plan for STEM OPT students. Essentially, they need to write a training plan and like justify how this qualifies and all that stuff. In other words, as you progress through the visas, you're going to find that the company is going to need to provide more and more information in order to qualify you for that visa, which means that less and less companies are going to be willing to do that because it's just more complicated. So for example, for CPT, like, essentially, any small startup who just started could probably go through the process, versus for OPT, it has to be a company that's willing to put the resources up to do all of this stuff. And then you take this whole package, you file it with the government, again, two-step process, and then you get back a new EAD card, which is a STEM OPT EAD card. And just by the way, between your STEM OPT and OPT visa, you can have max of 150 days of unemployment. Okay, that was a ton of information, but I'm glad I got it out there because I had to live through it every step of the way and figure it out from scratch, because no one really tells you what you need going forward for whatever reason. So let me just say that if you have any questions on any of these four visas, I can answer based on my experience. And then you might be wondering, okay, well, what if I want to stay in the US longer? This is when, at least among my friends, most people apply for like H-1B or O-1 or EB-1, or they go back to school. So there's a variety of ways to do it, but that is for another video.